Good morning. I'm a day early and a bit early, but I'm coming to you and continuing in the book of Acts. This passage in Acts 8 is one of my favorite unknown gems because it's such an insight into the world. Hi, Barbara. Of what was happening in Jerusalem and also in Samaria and what the new disciples encountered. And for them, it was just pretty much standard. So there were people, men mostly, who were traveling teachers. And we encounter Simon today. And Simon has created a good livelihood by probably buying other people's secrets in terms of tricks that they can do. So let me read, and I'm in Acts 8, I'm going 9 verse through 20 something. So I'm in the Message. So previously to Philip's arrival, a certain Simon had practiced magic in the city, posing as a famous man and dazzling all the Samaritans with his wizardry. He had them all, from little children to old men, eating out of his hand. They all thought he had supernatural powers and called him the Great Wizard. He had been around a long time and everyone was more or less in awe of him. But when Philip came to town announcing the good news of God's kingdom and proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ, they forgot Simon and were baptized, becoming believers right and left. Even Simon himself believed and was baptized. From that moment, he was like Philip's shadow, so fascinated with all the God signs and miracles that he wouldn't leave Philip's side. When the apostles in Jerusalem received the report that Samaria had accepted God's message, they sent Peter and John down to pray for them and to receive the Holy Spirit. Up to this point, they'd only been baptized in the name of the Master, Jesus. The Holy Spirit hadn't fallen upon them. Then the apostles laid hands on them, and they did receive the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw that the apostles, by merely laying the hands, conferred the Spirit, he pulled out his money, excited, and said, "Sell me your secret. Show me how you did that. How much do you want for that? Name your price." Peter said, "To hell with your money, and you along with it. Why, that's unthinkable. Trying to buy God's gift? You'll never be part of what God's doing by striking bargains and offering bribes. Change your ways, and now. Ask the Master to forgive you for trying to use God to make money. I can see this is an old habit with you. You reek of money lust." "Oh," said Simon, "pray for me. Pray to the Master for that nothing like this will happen ever to me." And with that, the apostles were on their way, continuing to witness and spread the message of God's salvation, preaching to every Samaritan town they passed through as they would return to Jerusalem. So here we go. There's human beings everywhere who want to make money out of, well, today it's God stuff, but then it was just tricks that they had learned. Maybe it was a certain thing that they could do with a plant. Maybe it was certain things they could do even with bodies to help them to ease pain. I mean, I go to a wonderful chiropractor who does amazing things to help my back and my legs and my knees. And so there were human beings, again, probably men, who would study with sages and learn their secrets and then go to another town. Again, you're not talking social media or anything. So when they went to the next town, they could claim it as their gift. They could claim that they knew the secret and they had discovered it. So here's Simon, and he's making some money in this town. And everybody is in awe of him. And, you know, once they're in awe of him, he can convince them of anything. So he makes a good living. Be clear that this is about making a living. He makes a good living from people by being the great wizard, as the book of Acts puts it. And once he sees the power that Philip has, The implication is that he follows him around not only because he likes the message that Philip is giving, but he wants to figure out Philip's secrets. How can he heal? How is he so commanding? How is this stuff working? And when Peter and John come from Jerusalem, he's even more than excited. So in the book of Acts, there's a very clear delineation between the baptism into Jesus' name and the giving of the Holy Spirit. And the baptism of the Holy Spirit was usually accompanied with a sign of the Spirit, such as the typical one is speaking in tongues or being able to prophesy or do one of those things. So when he sees that, he's like, this could really make me some money. And so he has wheeled and dealed throughout his life to buy different secrets from different people. He wasn't being mean or greedy from his perspective. From his perspective, he was just doing what he'd always done. And quite often when we enter the faith life, doing what we've always done gets us in trouble anyway. And I think that one of the reasons that this was included in the book of Acts, my opinion, is that there were people who were trying to sell the grace of God rather than as these first apostles were freely giving it. And in my day and in my time, I have met and seen human beings, again, mostly men, who have tried to sell the grace of God. I remember when there was a televangelist on the TV, and I said, oh, Dad, you could watch whoever it was. They were pretty notable back in the 70s and 80s and even 90s. And Dad said, oh, snake oil salesman. Because in his time and in his place, the thing that had happened was they weren't televangelists at the time. They were traveling preachers who had tent meetings. And these tent meeting people would come to town and, you know, bilk money out of people. That really was their goal, even though they were saying they were there for God and there to preach God's wisdom. But certainly they were taking money. And the church continued to do that. Understand that it's interesting that we read this when the Church of the Middle Ages, the Roman Catholic Church, was selling indulgences. That is, if you had done something wrong and you wanted forgiveness, you would pay a traveling, basically again, a traveling guy who could sell you forgiveness. And he would, you know, take your money and he would sell you God's forgiveness. So this is the history of our church as part of our history, that there's always been people who wanted to abuse and manipulate the name of God, who wanted to use the good news and the power of God to their own ends. And usually that end was greed. And here, you know, one of my favorite is, you know, Peter just saying, to hell with your money. We do not need that. This is not about money. And so I think, again, one of the reasons that the book of Acts is to say this is a different type of faith. Even Judaism at that time, not now, but at that time, was about making money for those in power. So the church has a long history of being manipulated. Well, not even the church. The story of God and the good news of God has been manipulated by those who wanted to use it to their own ends. Peter sets the story straight. This is free. You get in trouble for trying to sell God's stuff. And that God wants his message out there to everyone to let them know that they're loved and they're cared for and that we're not using it to get ourselves rich. I'm certainly not getting myself rich. But to freely give God's grace and to freely let God dwell in our hearts. And so Simon is one of my favorite interesting people in the book of Acts, the great wizard who tried to buy what was free for him, who tried to buy so he could use and manipulate it and get money from others. That is not what the church should be doing, ever. But we fall into old traps. So today, enjoy this day. Know that the grace of God and the love of God is free, no strings attached, and that hopefully we can share that free gift, wonderful gift, with everyone we encounter. Pray blessings upon you this day and strength for today. Take care. Bye.